open your hearts to God's loving mercy.
Lord, come into our hearts this day.
Having received God's mercy, bring that love to others.
Lord, be with us as we reach out to others in compassion.
Feel your spirits filled with the goodness of God.
Lord, we thank you for the many blessings which you pour into our lives. Amen.
Good evening. Is this evening or afternoon? Ish. We have a couple ish. We have some afternoons. Okay. Whatever it is for you, we are so grateful that you are here and able to worship with us, whether you are worshiping in person or online. We are just so grateful to have you here. Our announcements are today are just, this is a place and a time where we know that God meets us exactly where we are at. So as we pray to God for all that's happened last week and all that is coming up before us this week, as we talk to God and sing God's songs and hear people sing God's songs, we recognize that God is with us, and this is our time with God. So let us begin this time as we experience God's presence with the song, I Can Only Imagine, by Mercy Me.
To my knees, will I fall? Will I sing?
can only imagine when all I do is forever, forever worship you. I can only imagine.
There are some moments where I wish the camera could be reversed and you could just kind of see your reactions to certain things. And there are some moments where I really wish the camera could be reversed because I want to see my reaction to some things, and I would have loved to just see my reaction when a phone call popped up during the middle of that hymn at the end. Never happened before. But let us now together go to God in prayer. Lord, who lifts us up, reside in our hearts today. Help us to listen closely for your word to us. Remind us that you are always with us throughout all of our lives. Give us confidence in your presence so that we may go into your world ready to witness to your love through our works and our deeds. For we pray these things in Jesus' name.
Our Old Testament reading is from Exodus chapter 16, verses 2 through 15. The whole congregation of the Israelites complained against Moses and Aaron in the wilderness. The Israelites said to them, "If only we had died by the hands of the Lord in the land of Egypt, when we sat by the flesh pots and ate our fill of bread, for you have brought us out into the wilderness to kill this whole assembly with hunger." Then the Lord said to Moses, "I am going to rain bread from heaven for you, and each day the people shall go out and gather enough for the day. In that way I will test them, whether they will follow my instruction or not. On the sixth day, when they prepare what they bring in, it will be twice as much as they gather on the other days." So Moses and Aaron said to the Israelites, "In the evening you shall know that it was the Lord who brought you out of the land of Egypt. And in the morning you shall see the glory of the Lord, because he has heard your complaining against the Lord. For what are we that you are complaining against us?" And Moses said, "When the Lord gives you meat to eat in the evening, and your fill of bread in the morning, because the Lord has heard the complaining that you utter against him, what are we? Your complaining is not against us, but against the Lord." Then Moses said to Aaron, "Say to the whole congregation of the Israelites, 'Draw near to the Lord, for he has heard your complaining.'" And as Aaron spoke to the whole congregation of the Israelites, they looked toward the wilderness, and the glory of the Lord appeared in the cloud. The Lord spoke to Moses and said, "I have heard the complaining of the Israelites. Say to them, 'At twilight you shall eat meat, and in the morning you shall have your fill of bread. Then you shall know that I am the Lord your God.' In the evening, quails came up and covered the camp, and in the morning, there was a layer of dew around the camp. When the layer of dew lifted, there on the surface of the wilderness was a fine, flaky substance, as fine as frost on the ground. When the Israelites saw it, they said to one another, 'What is it?' For they did not know what it was. Moses said to them, 'It is the bread that the Lord has given you to eat.'" Our New Testament reading comes from Philippians chapter 1, verses 21 through 30. "For to me, living is Christ and dying is gain. If I am to live in the flesh, that means fruitful labor for me, and I do not know which I prefer. I am hard pressed between the two. My desire is to depart and be with Christ, for that is far better. But to remain in the flesh is more than necessary for you. Since I am convinced of this, I know that I will remain and continue with all of you for your progress and joy in faith, so that I might share abundantly in your boasting in Christ Jesus when I come to you again. Only live your life in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ, so that whether I come and see you or am absent and hear about you, I will know that you are standing firm in one spirit, striving side by side with one mind for the faith of the gospel, and are intimidated by your opponents. For them, this is evidence of their destruction, but of your salvation. And this is God's doing, for he has graciously granted you the privilege not only of believing in Christ, but of suffering for him as well, since you are having the same struggle that you saw I had, and now fear that I still have.
We now have the joy of coming together as a people of God to lift up our joys and our concerns. And we'll do this day the way we've been doing it throughout this pandemic. I'll start with a prayer, and then there'll be times of silence. And we invite you to lift up your joys and your concerns wherever they may fit. This is a time where if you're not comfortable speaking out loud, you can simply whisper it on our hearts. We know that God hears us no matter where we are at. Let us now go to God in prayer. Almighty God, we come to you after a week of ups and downs, bumps and bruises, highs and lows. We come to you with all that we are, with all that is going on in our lives, and all that we are grateful for and thankful for. All that worries us and all that scares us. Lord, hear us now as we pray. Be with us as we pray for Christians throughout the world, that we may know that nothing can separate us from the love of Christ. We pray to the Lord. Leaders of the nations and cities of the world, that they may be wise in their administration of government during this pandemic and selflessly serve the common good. We pray to the Lord. For all the bishops, pastors, district superintendents, and leaders of our congregations, that they may faithfully tend to the family of God during the season of social distancing. We pray to the Lord. Lord, we ask that you be with our conference this week as we have our first clergy session of annual conference, which will be held online. Help it to be effective. Help it to not take too long. But help us to see you amidst this new way of work. For doctors, nurses, and other healthcare workers who tend the sick and dying, that they fulfill their vocation without undue fear of personal danger, we pray to the Lord. For all who are sick and those alone in quarantine, that they may find comfort and care in their time of need, we pray to the Lord. The earth you have given to our care, and for all creatures who share it with us, that you may be glorified in all your works, we pray to the Lord. For those anywhere who have given their life for our freedom, we pray to the Lord. For other concerns, that we pray for the Lord. Pray to the Lord now.
Lord, pray for my family, especially for Rob and Trish, as they prepare for the wedding tomorrow. And you have blessings to you. And pray for my friends. I'm so glad that I'm able to get to them every once in a while. They are so supportive in my continued time of need. Pray for my church and all the churches of the world, that they be on the hill for all the people who are on the need.
we ask you to be with this church this week as we give out chicken dinners. It feels weird to do something sometimes that is just for others. But Lord, this is what you call us to feed others. So be with us on Monday as we prepare and Tuesday as we hand out meals. Help us to see your spirit as we come to the end of this amazing season of this ministry. Loving God, we, your children, never pray alone, but only with all your saints and all the world. Therefore, we pray just as Jesus taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven,
we believe.
Brotherly Abel, will you please stand as we hear this morning, this evening, this afternoon, right now's gospel lesson. It comes to us from Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 through 16. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire laborers for his vineyard. After agreeing with the laborers for the usual daily wage, he sent them out to his vineyard. When he went out about 9 o'clock, he saw others standing idle in the marketplace. And he said to them, "You also go into the vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. When he went out again about noon and about 3 o'clock, he did the same. And about 5 o'clock, he went out and found others standing around. And he said to them, "Why are you standing here idle all day?" They said to him, "Because no one has hired us." He said to them, "You also go into the vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his manager, "Call the laborers and give them their pay, beginning with the last and then going to the first." When those hired about 5 o'clock came, each of them received the usual daily wage. Now when the first came, they thought they would receive more, but each of them also received the usual daily wage. When they received it, they grumbled against the landowner, saying, "These last worked only for an hour, and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the day and the scorching heat." But he replied to one of them, "Friend, I am doing you no wrong. Did you not agree for me the usual daily wage? Take what belongs to you and go. I choose to give to the last the same as I give to you. Am I not allowed to do what I choose with what belongs to me? Or are you envious because I am generous?" So the last will be first and the first will be last. So if you're curious, or you saw why I did that one-eyed, I was back there and I put my mask on. And I put my mask on first, and then I reached up and put a mint in. And somehow it like tunneled all of it into my right eye. And it feels like someone put Bengay in my eye. So that's why. Man, it's a good thing I'm not ready for sermons now. Let us pray. Almighty and gracious God, we come to you this day with so much going on around us. Slow our minds, allow us to hear your word this day. Allow it to challenge us. Allow us to make it so that we are closer to you. We thank you for this opportunity to hear your word in this peaceful place. I ask you to take away my words and replace them with yours. Take away me and remind me and place me with you. We ask this all in your son's name, we pray. Amen. I'm going to talk about something that is very, very special to me, but is also very sacred. It's not politics, it's not finances, it's our dinner tables and our dinner plates. You may not realize it, but I found as I've gotten older, I found that one of the most kind of defensive things we have for some of us is our dinner plates. I learned this because I grew up with a family that held very close to that central PA religion of Sunday afternoon meals. I don't know about you, but if you grew up in central PA, those meals consisted of a meat, potatoes, some sort of vegetable. There would always be a side of bread, unless it's in my family, when we would normally forget the bread in the oven. It would depend whether or not the oven was on or not, if we'd realize it. And then normally a dessert. That was our Sundays. But what I liked more than that was the interactions we had with each other, just learning about my family, learning about, you know, the one Thanksgiving where my grandfather exclaimed out of nowhere, I once denutted a pig. And we went, "What?" He said, "Well, we were eating ham. I just was reminded of it." He grew up on a farm, so that part kind of made sense, but still it came out of nowhere. And I remember the jokes we talked about, the way in which I would get money from my parents and pretending to use different things. But the plates is where it happened. I don't know about you, but no matter where I'm at, I check out other people's plates. I will go, if we're at Hershey Park, and I'm not sure what I want to eat, I'll just walk around and look at people's plates until my stomach tells me what I want. But also, there's that point where, you may not do this, but I judge people by their plates. My uncle is gross because on his plate when he makes toast, he puts ketchup on his toast. Yes, that is disgusting. There is no way around that. It goes with other foods. I had the opportunity to be an amazing sitting co-parent with someone who is super crazy over her foods and whether or not they touch. Like, it's almost to a point there needs to be, like, a rogue in her plate. I don't know if you've seen people like that. None of it can touch. For me, if I get potatoes and corn, they're going together. I don't care if you meant for them to or not, it tastes better that way. There are just these little things about our plates. And I remember growing up. Now, in our era, we know that our era is different than the ones that are, for me, my grandparents grew up in, that kind of World War II era. And my grandmother always used to say to me, whenever I was done, because it wouldn't matter when I was done with my meal, no one could touch it. This was mine. I don't care if I didn't eat a single bite. It is not yours. This is my plate. Do not touch my food. Now, I've gotten better throughout the years. Mason helped with that a lot. But still, that first reaction is, you have your own plate. Get your hands off of mine. My grandmother always used to say, Brent Thomas, I swear, somewhere in you is the spirit of someone who grew up in a concentration camp. Man, that joke doesn't fly now. But even when she said it then, as a woman who married a man who helped free a concentration camp, I knew exactly what she meant. And I think all of you do, this idea that for me at this point, I kept everything and it was mine. But so often I'll start looking. And my grandmother has our amazing statement that we still say to this day. When someone is bothering me about my food or what I put on it or what I put in it or what I remove, I always say, mind your own business. Focus on your plate. This is my plate, that's yours. I used to hate it when my grandmother would tell me that, because it would be the automatic thing to just cut off any sort of discussion. But today, we kind of get the same thing in our text today. Today, our text is about someone who owned a vineyard and was hiring people throughout the day. And throughout the day, he would go out and find other people, and at the end of the day, it came time to pay everyone. And everyone came up thinking that because other people were brought up throughout different parts of the day, that they would get a different wage from this vineyard owner. The vineyard owner says, not really, that's not the way it's going to work. You all came to an agreement with me, you fulfilled your part, I'm going to fulfill my part. Keep your mind on your plate. But everyone in the area said, that is not fair. I have been here the entire time. And this schmuck just shows up and you give him the same amount of money? Really, what this is about is our faith communities. Those in which we let in and the excitement of God's grace shining over them versus our annoyance that we were here the whole time working and being good. And yet, God celebrates them. I don't think it's a surprise to anyone that I think the only part of this text I've ever heard preached or talked about was at summer camp, and into this last verse. And it was only used like once a year at camp, and I think it was like on a Tuesday, and we all knew on that Tuesday you had to get in the back of the line, because it was that time where we take this one text and it says, so the last will be first and the first will be last, and they switch everyone for breakfast. So if you're at the end of the line, you get to go first, and the other line, you get to the last. But that's not what the scripture's talking about. It's not about meals. It's about our relationship with God. It's about, are we spending our day focusing on someone else and God's interaction with them? Or are we looking at our own plates and being so grateful for all that God has given us that we don't care what anyone else is doing? See, that's what God calls for us. God calls for us to focus so much with our relationship with God that none of the other stuff matters. That you don't even have to focus on anyone else's relationship with God. I will admit that this text rings true to me, and sometimes I think clergy miss it because we know this text. We feel this text. We struggle in our own lives with this question of, are we focusing on our relationship with God, or are we just looking at other people's? During this time of meditation, I encourage you to ask that question, where is my focus? Is it on me and God and the grace that God has given me, that plate which fills us up every morning when we wake up like manna from heaven? Or are we focusing on others and what all is coming through at this time? Let us now go to God as we struggle with where our focus is on this day. brothers and sisters, go out into this day filled with the Holy Spirit. Go out called to spread the gospel in all you do, and when necessary, use words. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.